Hi students, I am Nimisha and I will be teaching your next science chapter, carbon and its compounds. Almost everything we touch around us has carbon in it. So carbon, any compound that has carbon in it is called an organic compound. The branch of chemistry that deals with the study of carbon is called organic chemistry. Why do we study this carbon in particular? Why not any other atom? Why not sodium, magnesium, a chapter on sodium or magnesium? Why carbon? Because you will study in this particular chapter, you will study the different natures of carbon due to which they form many bonds with any atom. Right? They form many bonds with different atoms. Okay. So now let's start with the basics. What is the atomic number of carbon? Atomic number of carbon is 6. Electronic configuration of carbon 2, 4. So now carbon has 4 here. It can either give away 4 electrons or take away 4 electrons. What will it do? We will study a little bit later. Okay. So it can either give away 4 electrons or take another 4. If it gives away these 4, 2 will be left satisfied. If it takes 4, it will become 8, satisfied. Now, how do we decide whether it should give or take? Right? If there was the number 5 here, you will decide, oh, let it take 3 instead of giving away 5. Or if there is number 3 over there, you will decide, okay, let's give away the 3 instead of taking another 5. What about this 4? If it gives away the 4, it becomes C4 plus cation. See, if you have 6 protons here, 1 electron here, 1 electron here, 1 electron here. If I remove 1 electron, now 6 protons are holding 5 electrons. Energy became more. 6 protons, imagine I have 6 fingers. On the 6 fingers, I have 6 bags of cover put away, some bags. If I remove 1 bag, now I have 6 fingers to hold 5 bags. It is more easier to hold. Now, I will remove 1 more bag. So, I have 6 fingers, that is the 6 protons, to hold 4 bags. More easy to hold. If I suddenly make it 2 bags, more easy. But so, now what happens? It is going to be difficult to remove 1 more bag. That means it's more energy it's holding. So, as you remove 1 electron, the 6 protons hold the remaining electrons very strongly. It does not allow the other electrons to easily go away. So, high energy is required to remove these 4 electrons, not possible. So, 6-4 plus cation, not possible. What about anion? I have only 6 fingers and you have put 6 bags on my hand. Okay. Now, on top of that, I come and tell, okay, now you hold this one also. You somehow say, okay, I'll hold it. Now, 6 protons are holding 7 people, 7 bags. You put 1 more. More difficult. So, you keep loading it. The 6 protons cannot hold so many. So, this 6-4 minus anion is not possible because it cannot hold, 6 protons cannot hold 10 electrons. So, it does not want to give away. It does not want to take. So, what does it decide to do? It decides to share electrons. It decides to share electrons. It does not give, does not take. So, it decides to share electrons with another carbon atom or another atom who needs the electron. So, the valence electrons, how many valence electrons? Electrons in the last shell, that's 4. And it decides to share 4. So, that's why valency is also 4. How many ever is involved in the bonding to get satisfied, that is complete electronic configuration, that is only your valency. So, 4 involved. What is a hydrocarbon? Compounds containing only of hydrogen and carbon are called hydrocarbon. Simple. I told you these carbon atoms decide to share electrons, right? So, the bond formed by the sharing of electrons. They are sharing means what? If there is sodium and chloride, sodium will give away one electron, he will take it and keep. Okay? and they are here together. In sharing, they both decide to keep and hold the electron together. They share, they're holding it together. So the bond formed by the sharing of electrons are called covalent bonds. The compounds formed by the sharing of electrons are called covalent compound. Sharing of electrons between whom? Between atoms. So you should say the bond formed by the sharing of electrons between atoms are called covalent bonds, and the compounds formed by the sharing of electrons between atoms are called covalent compounds. So now we understood what is a covalent compound, and you already know ionic compounds. What is the difference between covalent compounds and ionic compounds? Covalent compounds are formed by the sharing of electrons. Ionic compounds are formed by losing or gaining electrons. Covalent compounds are found in solid, liquid or gaseous state. Ionic compounds are usually found always in solid state. Why, you will understand in one of these points. Covalent compounds are insoluble in water but soluble in organic solvents. Example of an organic solvent is benzene. We will learn what is benzene again a little more deeper into this chapter. Ionic compounds are soluble in water but insoluble in organic solvents. Covalent compounds have weak intermolecular force of attraction. They are holding the electron together. It's weak intermolecular force of attraction. Ionic compounds have strong intermolecular force of attraction. Why? It gives and takes electrons, so plus and minus, strong electrostatic force, if you remember. So strong intermolecular force of attraction, which is why, because this is weak, it can be liquid or gas. Since this is strong, all the atoms are closely packed. Closely packed means solid, right? And because it's weak intermolecular force of attraction, with little energy, I can break the bond. I can break the bond. So it has low melting point and low boiling point. Intermolecular force of attraction is strong in the case of ionic compounds. They strongly held, so I need lot of energy to break them. So high melting point and boiling point. Covalent compounds do not conduct heat and electricity. Ionic compounds, yes, they do conduct heat and electricity, but you've already studied this in the metals and non-metal chapter about ionic compounds. They conduct heat and electricity in aqueous state or molten state. Why? Because in aqueous state or molten state, the ions can break, can ionize, and hence behave as charges and conduct electricity. Yes. The next topic we'll be studying is electron dot structure. How do you draw the electron dot structure? Basically, if a compound is formed, how are the electrons shared? How does the structure look? So before we go into drawing our first electron dot structure, we need to know the electronic configuration of a few atoms. Mainly these atoms, because they'll be repeating continuously in this chapter. So electronic configuration, I will just write down a few things here. Let's write atomic number here. Next, after atomic number, you have electronic configuration and how many electrons will it share. Okay, so what's the atomic number of carbon? 6. Electronic configuration of carbon, K shell, L shell, M. 2, 8, 8, 18, right? So 6, electronic configuration 2, 4. It will share the same valence electrons, so it will share 4. O, oxygen is 8, 2, 6, it will share how many? It wants 2 more to become 8, it wants 2 more to become 8. So how many will it share? It will share 2. So when it shares 2, it will get an additional 2, so it becomes 8. Hydrogen, atomic number 1, it has only 1. It will share 1 to become 2. Nitrogen, atomic number 7, 2, 5. It wants to become 8, right? So it has to share 3. Sulfur, 16, 2, 8, 6. It needs another 2, so it shares 2. Chlorine, 17. 2, 8, 7, it needs a 1, so it shares only most gases, if they individually exist, they exist in diatomic state. That means if I say hydrogen gas, it does not exist as HHH. It exists as H2. Right? So now we're going to draw the electron dot structure for hydrogen. There's one hydrogen atom here. There is one more hydrogen atom here. This hydrogen has one electron and it wants to share. This hydrogen atom also has one electron and it wants to share. So they both decide, come on, let's share, let's shake hands. They both decide to share. So this hydrogen basically has two electrons, satisfied. This hydrogen basically has two electrons, also satisfied. So this is the electron dot structure of hydrogen. Let's now try for chlorine. Chlorine's atomic number you learnt was 17. That is how much? 2, 8, 7. It has 7 valence electrons. In electron dot structure, you should draw all the valence electrons. So there are 2 chlorine atoms here. They want to share only one. They want to share only one. But each chlorine has 7. So draw the remaining 6. One is sharing, it has remaining 6. One is sharing, it has remaining 6. So now if you can see, this chlorine has 7 of its own and one of the additional chlorine. And here it has 7 of its own and one additional from this chlorine. So totally 7 plus 1, 8. 7 plus 1, 8. Satisfied. These circles that I are drawing, not compulsory. As the atoms become complicated, I'll stop drawing the circle. These are simple, so I draw it. We have hydrochloric acid and water as the next two examples. Let's try. So hydrogen atomic number 1, chlorine atomic number 17, so 2, 8, 7. Hydrogen needs one more, chlorine also needs one more. They both decide to share. So hydrogen has 1 and chlorine, it's a different atom, so I'm using dots here. You have to vary the sign, cross and dots. Okay, chlorine 7. So it wants to share only 1 and it has an additional of 6. So they both decide to share, right? They both decide to share. Now, hydrogen has 1 plus 1. So it has 2, satisfied. Chlorine has 7 of its own and 1 of hydrogen, also satisfied. Okay. Next. H2O. Oxygen is atomic number 8. That is 2, 6. Hydrogen is 1. Wants to share 2, wants to share 1. So each hydrogen wants 1 each and oxygen has 2 to share. So the oxygen over here will decide to share 2 of its own. It wants to share 2 because it wants 2 more. But it has 6, so show the remaining 4 electrons. Now it decides to share with the hydrogen. Hydrogen wants to share 1. This hydrogen also wants to share 1. So they both decide to share. So oxygen is sharing 2, hydrogen is sharing 1, hydrogen is sharing 1. So if you see here, hydrogen has 2. This hydrogen also has 2. Oxygen has 6 of its own plus 7 and 8. So oxygen gets its 8. This is your electron dot structure of water. Next compound, ammonia, which is NH3. Nitrogen atomic number 7, configuration 2, 5. Hydrogen atomic number 1. So each N, the N wants 3. The N wants 3 to become 8. And each hydrogen wants 1. How many hydrogens do you have? 3 hydrogens. So N wants to share 3. With whom? With hydrogen. With whom? With hydrogen. With whom? With hydrogen. And it has totally a 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So each hydrogen gets 2. Satisfied. And nitrogen has 5 of its own plus it's got additional 3 shared electrons from hydrogen. So it becomes a 8. Satisfied. Oxygen. I told you, atomic gases, if it's a single element, then it exists as in the diatomic state. So this is O2. O is 8, that is 2, 6. So each oxygen wants to share 2. Each oxygen wants to share 2. But each oxygen has a total of 6. That means it has additional 4. So draw the additional 4. This oxygen has 6 plus 2, 8. This oxygen has 6 plus 2, 8. Next you have nitrogen gas N2. So N is what? 7, 2, 5. It wants to share 3. So write 2 N's. They want to share 3 each. So let them share. And you have an additional 2, additional 2. So basically 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of its own plus an additional 3. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of its own plus an additional 3. Please remember, while bonding, while forming covalent bonds, you have single bond, double bond meaning 2 bonds, and triple bond. Do we have more than 3 bonds? No. Maximum is 3 bonds only. Carbon dioxide. So each carbon, 2, 4, because atomic number is 6, oxygen is 2, 6, wants to share 2, wants to share 4. Carbon wants to share 4. Each oxygen wants to share 2. Each oxygen wants to share 2. So it shares 2, shares 2. See, oxygen is sharing 2, oxygen is sharing 2, carbon is sharing 4. But each oxygen has 6, that means 2 plus 4. So put the remaining 4 electrons. Now draw your circles. So oxygen has a 6 plus 2, 8. 6 plus 2, 8. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 8 for the carbon. H2S, hydrogen sulfide. Each H is 1. Sulfur is 16. That is 2, 8, 6. So sulfur wants to share 2. But it has a total of 6. So it wants to share 2. It shares with 1 hydrogen each. You can leave it as it is. It is totally okay if you don't put the circles. Okay, I have shown you how to put the circles. So I'm not going to draw circles for this one, just so that you know it is okay. Fluorine atomic number 9. 2, 8, 1. It wants to share 1. Fluorine atomic number 9, configuration 2, 7. It wants to share 1. So both the fluorines will decide to share 1, but it has 7. So remaining 6, put the remaining 6. It has 7, put the remaining 6. So if you want, you can put the circles. How will you put? Circle for this, circle for this. Even if you don't put, it is okay. Fine. So how will it look with circles? Right. Sulfur exists in 2 states, S6 and S8. Okay. So how do we draw it? Sulfur atomic number 16, 2, 8, 6 wants to share 2. So now S6 will be something like this. So it wants to share 2, right? It shares 2. Each one will share 2. You can see here it's 6, right? So I need additional 4. Need additional 4. It need additional 4. It need additional 4. If you look at the structure, it's in the form of a chair. So this is called a chair structure. S8. So S. Draw 5 like this. Another 3 are pending. Follow this pattern. Now join each one to the other. You can see this structure looks like a crown. So it's a crown structure. Each sulfur has additional 4 electrons. Please draw that additional 4. Do not forget it. additional 4, additional 4. So this is a chair structure of sulfur, that's a crown structure of sulfur, S6 and S8. The next concept, allotropes of carbon. What are allotropes? Allotropes are substances made of the same element but differ in physical properties. For example, diamond. All of you have seen diamonds? Yes, in earrings, so many people wear diamond earrings, right? So diamond, and all of you have used a pencil. That lead you see in a pencil is not made of lead metal. It is made of graphite. Graphite is nothing but carbon itself. Diamond is also a form of carbon. Graphite is also a form of carbon. Purely made of carbon, purely made of carbon. But do they even look alike? No. So they are chemically made of the same element, but physically, if you look at them, physical properties vary. Diamond is the hardest substance. Graphite is soft. You can also break it. This is not a conductor of heat or electricity. This is a conductor. And one more form, allotrope form of carbon is Buckminster fullerene. So the three allotropes of carbon are diamond, graphite, Buckminster fullerene, or just fullerene. Next concept, important concept, usually a standard question. Versatile nature of carbon. What is the meaning of versatile? You are versatile. You easily adapt to any atmosphere, can talk to anybody. Similarly, versatile nature of carbon. Carbon can adapt to any atmosphere, is present in a lot of substances around us. So it's very versatile. What makes carbon versatile? Another reason they can also ask for the same question, another form of this question can be, why do carbons form large compounds? Or they can even ask you, why is carbon present in a lot of compounds? Why do carbons form large compounds? What is the reason for versatile nature of carbon? Two reasons, catenation and tetravalency. Catenation and tetravalency. What is catenation? Carbon has the unique ability to keep forming bonds with other carbon atoms. Carbon has the unique ability to keep forming bonds with other carbon atoms, thus forming very, very large compounds. Thus forming very, very large compounds. This property is called catenation. Is it there only in carbon, or other atoms can also show catenation? See, first of all, you need to share 4 electrons or show that kind of covalent bonding, and then it's possible. What about silicon? It has atomic number 14. Does it also, so it's 2, 8, 4. Does it also show catenation? Not as much as carbon. Carbon has ability to show more catenation than silicon. Why? Because of its small size. This is large size. So to form silicon, bulky, it will become bulky. So it's very, very big, difficult to hold them. So weak bonds. Because of its small size, it shows better extent of catenation. Tetravalency. Carbon has a valency 4. Tetra meaning 4. This is valency. So valency 4. This valency, because its valency is 4, it gives the ability for carbon to form 4 more bonds with other carbons. Or instead of other carbons, it can also form with different other atoms or monovalent atoms, meaning other atoms that want to share one electron, hydrogen or anything, right? This property is called tetravalency. Because the valency is 4, it can form bonds with 4 other carbon atoms or other monovalent atoms. What are the different other atoms that it can form bonds with? We learnt a few at the beginning over here, and I told you we'll be repetitively using this in this chapter. Oxygen, hydrogen, nitrogen, chlorine, sulfur. These mainly, there are few others, but we'll be studying these. So it can form bond with any of this. Why? Because again, because of its small size. So its size has a very good role to play in the property of both. So catenation and tetravalency are the two properties responsible for the versatile nature of carbon, or for carbon to form large compounds. What are the different types of hydrocarbons? There are two types of hydrocarbons, saturated hydrocarbons and unsaturated hydrocarbons. What are hydrocarbons? Hydrocarbons are compounds made of only carbon and hydrogen. Unsaturated. Saturated hydrocarbons are those compounds that are linked only with single bonds. Unsaturated hydrocarbons are those that are linked with double bonds or triple bonds. Example of saturated is alkane. What are alkanes? We will learn it a little later. For now, just learn alkanes, an example for saturated hydrocarbons. Example for unsaturated hydrocarbons is alkene and alkyne. Double bond, alkene. Triple bond, alkyne. Again, what is alkene? What is alkyne? We will study in the next section. Homologous series. What is homologous series? Homologous series are a series of compounds that have the same functional group, similar chemical properties, and every successive member, next member, differs by a CH2 group. It sounds like Greek and Latin, correct? You will learn it when I do my first series. The series are alkane and alkene. Just remember, they have to have the same functional group, similar chemical properties, and successive members should differ by a CH2 group. What does it mean exactly? You will understand clearly when I take the first example, alkane. Functional group. Functional group. What is a functional group? We use functional group here. What is that functional group? Functional group is nothing but an atom or a group of atoms. Heteroatoms means different atoms together. So it can be a group of atoms or group of heteroatoms that confer specific properties. That means it gives specific properties to a compound regardless of its length and nature of the carbon chain. That means if I have many carbons here and I add OH, or I have just few carbons and I add OH, both of them will have similar chemical properties, because the same functional group is added. So when OH is added to both, OH is called alcohol, you learn it. When alcohol is added to both, alcohol group, both these compounds become alcohol because the functional group. Are they exactly same? No, but they'll have similar properties. Some specific properties are added to both of them just because of the alcohol group. Okay, you'll understand better about these two when I do the next part of the chapter. So I told you that carbon is present in a lot of compounds around us, right? So we have to have some kind of nomenclature, meaning naming, to name those compounds, because we have 100,000 of carbon compounds. How do we name them? So we have one kind of naming. Before we understand how to name those compounds, let us first study the different functional groups we have. These are the functional groups that we have. Starting from halogen. Halogen is nothing but chlorine, bromine and fluorine. They all want to form single bonds. In general, you can represent halogens as hyphen X. While using halogens as a functional group, when you attach it to a carbon compound, then how do they affect the name of the compound? They become a prefix. And you add chloro, bromo, fluoro. So, in other words, halo, chloro, bromo, fluoro. Okay. Alcohol. The next functional group, alcohol. Alcohol is given by the formula OH and a dash. The dash indicates a bond to be formed. And that if you show an empty bond like this, that means it's a group. That's why functional group. Groups are attached to somebody else. So here, who's the somebody else? Nothing but the carbon compound. So how is it actually formed? The formula, oxygen needs two bonds. So one it forms with hydrogen, one more is left empty. This is the structure. This is the formula group, if you just concise it. Okay, if they ask you to draw the structure of alcohol group, you have to draw this and also mention the additional electrons of oxygen. Next, we come to aldehyde, represented by the formula CHO. And it needs one more bond. How? So here the carbon forms one bond with hydrogen and two bonds with oxygen. So 1, 2, 3 occupied, 1 remaining. So it becomes a CHO group, aldehyde. I forgot to mention whether it adds as a prefix or suffix. If an alcohol group is added to a carbon compound chain, it adds as a suffix. OL. Alcohol gets OL. So methanol, ethanol. You learn all that. Okay. Aldehyde. Aldehyde. It gets the suffix AL. Al. Methanol. Ethanol. Propanol. You'll understand that when I take examples of what I just said. Ketone. Formula CO, but it has two bonds pending. So how does this look? C double bond O, this dash. So two carbon chains have to come on the two sides. Carboxylic acid. We've already seen one or two acids, carboxylic acids in the previous chapters. What was it? Ethanoic acid or acetic acid, if you remember. Carboxylic acid is given by COOH. So even this one forms C double bond O. Even this one has double bond O. Even this one has double bond O, double bond O. But here it attached to two carbons. Here one has gone to hydrogen. Here one goes to OH. So how OH? This O is satisfied. H satisfied. C has two bonds with O, one bond with O, and one more bond remaining. So I hope all the structures are clear. Ketone gets the name O-N-E, own, propanone, methanone. Carboxylic gets the name oic acid or oic acid. So I'm going to use all of this when I do the nomenclature, which is what we're going to be studying next.